Welcome, John. Mr. Hodges, how are you doing today?
Very well, thanks. Good to see you again, Jennifer. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you for asking. I'm going to go ahead and introduce you to everyone, and we'll get started with our discussion. Okay.
Very good. Very good.
This is John Hodges. He is a conductor, a lecturer, composer, and writer. For 26 years, he was music director at various orchestras after finishing graduate studies in music at Indiana University in 83. He also has 14 years experience conducting, composing, and arranging music for churches. He lectured extensively on the subjects of aesthetics, education, and music, and writes occasional articles for publications on the arts. He held the position of Associate Professor of the Arts and Culture at Creighton, is that correct?
That's right.
Creighton College, where he taught classes in worldview, history of arts and music, and Reader's Theater. Directed theater productions and was founding director of the Institute of the Arts and Cultural Apologetics. Most recently, he has founded and directs the Center for Western Studies, a gap year program, tutorial program that teaches college-age students a Christian worldview and the history of Western ideas by way of the great books, art, music, and philosophy. He lives in Memphis with Day, his wife of 30 years, and they have one son, Mason.
That's right.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We're so glad that you could come here today. And so what we're doing today is talking about listening to music.
Right.
And kind of the inspiration for this whole thing was David Hicks' quote in Norms and Nobility. And I'll go ahead and read the quote to start off our discussion. Okay. The Paiduic man's attitude towards such activities as painting, drawing, violin playing, dancing, and acting is amateurish, not professional. He knows that one cannot learn the culture defined by these activities passively, since our culture is the unique property of the participant, not the spectator. The classical academy resists the modern tendency to select only the most talented for participating. And that's from David Hicks, Norms and Nobility, Chapter 9. So my first question for you is, how does that quote, or what thoughts come to your mind related to listening to music when you hear that quote?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is the notion that that an amateur is one who loves. The root of that word amateur is one who loves something, right? A lover. So, yes, we in every way ought to be interested in music and the arts and so on as a lover of those things. And lovers want to participate in and engage in and get involved in the thing that they're talking about, not just stand off on the sideline and watch it from afar. So what a great idea to talk about how music can be heard. How should we best be involved with music? As Christians.
Wonderful. Thank you.
It's easy for us to turn the arts into a sort of professional thing where only the experts participate and everybody else stands around and looks. But for the most part, for the history of the world, we've always had experts, but we've also had the participation of the general public in the activity. So people learned how to play the piano or the violin or learned how to sing or read music or how to listen to music.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I find that is common. Even with myself, I'll think, oh, well, I can't do that. That's not my forte. That's not, you know, what I'm good at. So, but there's something else that's going on here that we should all attend to. And
right.
I think we're going to attend to some of that today together, aren't we?
Good.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Hope to.
Do you want to tell us about the piece that we're listening to? We're actually going to listen to a piece and talk through it.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, in the early 60s, Leonard Bernstein was asked to compose a piece of music for a festival, an annual festival, or maybe it was biannual, now I think about it. Anyway, at Chichester Cathedral in England. And they wanted a piece of music that would set the Psalms, some Psalms from the Bible. And Bernstein took up the challenge and wrote a piece called the Chichester Psalms. And in it are three movements, and each movement includes a part or all of two different psalms. So there are two psalms in each one, somewhat contrasted, if you see what I mean. So the first one has a very short bit of a psalm that says, awake, psaltery, and harp, I will awake the dawn. In other words, a call to worship. And then sets the entire, pretty much the entire Psalm 100. In the second movement, you have the Psalm 23, the famous shepherd psalm of David, compared with the beginning of Psalm 2. So Psalm 23 is very calm and peaceful and pastoral and so on. And the beginning of Psalm 2, if you remember, is why do the nations rage? Why do the Gentiles rage against God? And so there's a kind of pitting against the calmness of 23, the struggles of the world. And then in the third movement, you have two more psalms, and we can talk about those maybe when we get to them. But they're another pair of psalms. One of them is Psalm 131, I think it is. Yeah. I should look at that. But but it ends with Psalm 133, just the verses that say, "Behold, how good and wonderful it is that brothers should dwell together in unity," and it ends with that unity.
Okay. All right. And so what shall we begin with? Do you want me to start with the first and then just...
Let's hear the first. Let's hear the opening segment. It's very short. It's just an introduction, but it tells you something important about the piece. And that is this melody that he has written that goes... it goes B flat, F, E flat, A flat, B flat. It's that little segment. It's a little motive that he has that he uses here, and he uses in a couple of other places, and then ends the piece with it. So it's kind of a unifying factor. Okay. So what you'll hear is that figure, dum bum 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 bum, and then all of it moved up a step, bum 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 bum. And then turned upside down, bum 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 bum, and again, dee da bum 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 bum, and then we're finished. It's just that little motive four times.
Okay.
So why don't we listen to that opening, and then see if you can hear that.
Okay. Now, before we listen to that, is there anything else you want to tell the listeners what we should be listening for, other than the construct
that motive? You can tell that it is a declamation, that it's a call, it's striking, right? The first note is very striking, and the harmonies are very sort of Jewish folk harmonies. So listen for that too.
Okay.
See if you can catch all that.
Well, then I'll press play and you just cue me when to stop.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go.
You heard bum 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 bum, and then bum 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 bum, and then turn it upside down. Beep bum 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 bum, beep bum 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 bum. That's the little motive. That's what we call a motive. It is the sort of germ that generates lots and lots of melodies.
Okay. Right. And
what you heard them chanting in Hebrew was singing in Hebrew. was awake, lyre and harp, awake, wake up. I will awake the dawn with my call to worship.
I like that. It reminds me of at the beginning of the epic poems of Homer and Virgil when they call the muses.
Right.
The muses, in a sense.
It's funny, you know. You hear Muslim calls to prayer. You know how they stand up in the minaret and they call out to the people to come to prayer. And if you listen to that singing, a lot of the ancient Christian, Christianity predates the Muslims. A lot of what they do actually comes from what the early church did. So it's that same idea of the Jewish call to worship. Come to the temple. Come and offer your hearts and your sacrifices and so on to God. And they kind of imitate that a little bit. We think it sounds very foreign to us, but it's really that's really where it came from the old Jewish traditions.
Oh, wow. Okay. Am I continuing at a certain point now? What shall we listen to next?
Well, would you like, let's hear a little bit of Psalm 100. You can go right where you were. You'll hear a piece before you, let me tell you about it first. Okay. It's in seven beats in a bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Like that. So it's a sort of dance, but it's a interesting kind of offbeat dance. It's a sort of interesting offbeat dance. So listen to a little bit. It's very very happy, but it's very Jewish sounding.
Okay.
So listen to the very beginning of it. See if you can hear a little of that. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. That the Lord, He is God. He has made us and not we ourselves. After this little interlude, the soloists come in and the chorus sings again, "For the Lord, He is good." Steadfast love endures forever. Now they say, "The Lord is good." That's how it ends. Mm. Isn't that wonderful? So they're singing, "Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who's made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture." and then enter into his gates with thanksgiving. That was that bum bum da da bum da 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 bum. That's great celebration. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. And then it ends with Ki Tov Adonai, the Lord is good. And that word Tov there is the same word that God uses in Genesis 1 to describe the world that he makes. After every day, he says, it's good.
Wow.
The Lord, he is good, it says. The Lord is good.
Wow.
His steadfast love endures forever and his faithfulness to all generations. Isn't that a great psalm?
That is a great psalm. I thought, when I imagine what the psalms sound like when I read the psalms, I kind of imagine what would they have sounded like if I was with the Hebrew people and they were singing,
yeah.
And I heard them. And so it's interesting to me to see how Bernstein, is that how you pronounce it, Bernstein?
He's always said Bernstein, but yeah.
Bernstein, interprets how to put music to these psalms.
Yes. And to hear it from a kind of folk Jewish, you know, feel. The rhythms of it, the harmonies of it, sort of the melodies, the sort of modal melodies from the Hebrew tradition, all of that is in there.
Yeah.
If you'd like to listen to the beginning of the second movement, you could hear how it is that he sets the beginning of Psalm 23.
Okay.
You know, when David wrote Psalm 23, King David wrote that, right? But we think of David as a young man or a young boy fighting Goliath, you know? And so what Bernstein did was set the shepherd David, the young boy David, singing this psalm as though he were out on the field, you know, singing it. And so he gets a boy alto to sing, a boy who before his voice has changed, you know,
okay,
to sing. So it sounds like a girl, but it's a boy singing. And he sings, the Lord is my shepherd, right off the bat.
Okay.
You'll hear the instrument that accompanies him is the instrument you associate with David, the harp.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. So we're going to listen to that for a little bit.
Yeah, let's hear a little of that.
Okay.
Adonai Roi. So he was singing, the Lord is my shepherd, I will want for nothing. Now, if you move ahead a little bit, over the next little section, you'll hear the entrance of the men. So far, you only hear the women and the alto. Boy. Psalm 2. singing, "You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemy." Just when you think it's over, and that's the end of it. Stop it there, and let me explain. What you just heard was the two melodies played at the same time, so you get the Lamarag Shugoyim, the why do the nations rage from Psalm 2, and the mumbling and grumbling and anger of the men's parts. And over top of them, you hear the Psalm 23 peaceful, calm melody. Mm-hmm. And eventually the men's part disappears and the calmness continues. So David's psalm wins out in the end.
I find this very interesting, especially since just last week we studied Psalm 2 in our Bible study, and the way that we did it, we're following a couple scholars that kind of, they take the parts in Chronicles that they feel like go with the Psalms, like possibly this Psalm could have been written during this time kind of thing, or there's some very strong topical connections to this part of Chronicles and this psalm and so on and so forth. And the what they paired up, they two different scholars paired up Psalm 2 with two different situations. The first one was when David was receiving the covenant from God. Yeah, God was saying, "This is what I'm promising you." And then the other one was Hannah, when she was going through waiting for Samuel, her son.
Oh.
And so I thought it was, it was all about waiting on your inheritance from the Lord, getting it from God rather than searching for it for yourself. And so when the men came in this angry voice, I was like, oh, I wonder why. And why did Bernstein, of course, I always go to why, and maybe I shouldn't do that. I don't know. But maybe Bernstein, why did he choose to have David as a shepherd during Psalm 23, I always imagine him being a king when he's Psalm 20. So just a lot of those thoughts were going through my mind as I was listening.
Yeah, interesting. Well, Psalm 23, of course, is all about of God being a shepherd, mm-hmm. and caring for us as David was caring for his sheep when he was younger. So he could make that metaphor work. He could make that picture work. And the first four verses in Psalm 2 is why do the nations rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed.
Yeah.
And of course, that's who David was. So it's all the grumbling and bitterness and upset, you know, and anger and so on. But what Bernstein's take was that the Lord being my shepherd and wanting for nothing, and the peace that he leads me through through the valley of the shadow of death, and I'll fear no evil and all that, is the counteraction to all the raging nations and the upset of the world. And what he writes musically is that Psalm 23 wins out in the end. The tune actually wins out, and the boy comes back and sings as though nothing has happened. But the first thing he sings after all the warfare has settled down is, "You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies."
Wow. So it's like he interprets the scripture, Psalm 2, with Psalm 23, in a sense.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly.
That's profound.
Each of these movements pits two psalms against each other, not exactly against each other, but at least in contrast, in relation to one another. So, What you get in the beginning of the third movement is that tune again, you know, the tune from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. Bum, 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 bum. And it is harmonized in a very different way. Okay. So it has a great deal of anxiety and upsetness in it. And I think it represents the struggles of life in a fallen world, the difficulties that we have day to day in our normal lives. And it's just instrumental, but it's that tune. Mm-hmm. And then that tune comes to a crisis point and then gets something changes, something resolves, something happens that's new and different. And it leads into the chorus singing from Psalm 131, Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty, neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too wonderful for me. Mm. It's a kind of peacefulness that comes knowing that God's in charge and I'm not, and that's okay.
Yeah.
And the latter part of it is I've quieted myself like a child weaned of its mother.
Mm-hmm.
Even as a soul, my soul is even as a weaned child. And it ends with, let Israel hope in the Lord.
Mm.
So it's beautiful.
Yeah.
Then, right at the end of everything, it seems like it goes higher and higher and higher, reaching up higher and higher into heaven, and then finally releases everything, and the orchestra stops playing, and only the chorus sings a cappella, and they sing one verse from Psalm 133, and that's the verse that I mentioned earlier. Behold how good and pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. And that's the last thing you hear.
Wow.
So it's all a comment about the wars of the day, you know, the struggles and trials of life, and how it is that God actually supersedes all that, is above all of that, and can actually bring peace to the world, I think.
That's
it's a
beautiful
piece.
Shall we listen?
Want to hear a little of that? Yeah, let's hear a little of that.
From the beginning?
Let's start at the very beginning of three.
Okay, here we go.
See if you can catch the tune.
Okay.
You hear it? Here it is again. And again. Lord, my heart is not haughty. There's a good place to stop or to move forward. If you can go forward a little bit, I'll play you the very end of it. There's a wonderful cello quartet that plays right there that you don't want to miss. So don't miss listening to the whole piece. But for our time, maybe we push ahead to the end. Okay. And you'll hear a couple of soloists working their way up higher and higher and higher, each outdoing the other one until finally they just evaporate into heaven. Listen to that little bit if you can find it. They're finished. And now you hear, behold how good and pleasant it is. Listen for the opening tune. Then all that's left to say is Amen. And that's how it ends.
Wow.
Isn't that something?
That is beautiful. I could feel the struggle at the beginning of it, and it reminded me of repentance. Like there, but then that one melody is that how I would used a word, a certain term earlier. What was that?
Motive.
Yes.
You mean
that motive?
Little four note motive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
that kept repeating over and over again. And it was, and I don't know if this is a correct interpretation or if it should be interpreted sometimes, but that it, through the repentance, through everything, God was still there. There was this thing that kept repeating that remained through the enemies, through the repentance, through, because I felt like Psalm 131 was more about your personal, like, this is about God, where the one before was about David and his enemies, and the one before was about Israel and God. So it was like nation, then, I don't know.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. It gets more personal as it goes, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Yeah, I think, you know, in music, you have two elements. In any art, you have two elements. You have something that unifies the piece, and you have diversity around that unity.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're hearing here, is this sort of unifying motive. It comes up again and again and again, and it gives a kind of wholeness to the whole work. But mm-hmm. But when you hear it, it's in different guises each time.
Right.
But it's always there, you see. And I think it's not accidental that our art is the most satisfying to us when it has both of those characteristics in it, unity and diversity, which is, of course, what mm-hmm. the Trinity is, right? Both unified and diverse at the same time.
Yeah. We've been talking about this dichotomy, this tension a lot lately, the different and the one and the many, and just just over and over again, you see it everywhere. Once you learn about it for the first time, you can't not see it everywhere.
Yes, but it's true. It's true. And the Greeks, you know, especially the pre-Socratics, but all the Greeks struggled with what is the ultimate reality, one or many. And of course, then the Christian truth comes along that God is both at the same time.
Right.
That they were both right and both wrong. They wanted something good in each of them, but God offers a triune self. So it's no wonder why we thought both of those were so important.
Yes. Thank you so much.
And I think art, you know, if art is too unified, then it's boring. If you heard that same theme over and over and over again, after a while you think, well, okay, what's, right. you know, what's next? What's happening next? If you heard it once and never again, and it was just a free flowing, continually new thing, so that it was totally diverse without any unity, it would be chaotic and hard to follow.
Right.
That's just the way it is. So you can see it in painting, you can see it in sculpture and architecture, but you can also see it in music. Mm-hmm. And when you have the two of them together, it's very powerful.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for leading us through that piece.
My pleasure. I hope you'll all go and listen to the entire thing. It's really worthwhile.
And that's the Chichester Psalms by Bernstein. And
right.
I bought mine. Mine is by, the one we listened to is produced by the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra and Robert Shaw. Huh? And it was created
in
1989. So that's the one we listened
to. Great conductor.
Good.
He was a great choral conductor. He did a lot of wonderful choral work in Atlanta.
Okay, wonderful. I'm glad I chose a good one then.
very good.
Okay, so before we end today, is there is there anything else that we want to say about music, about listening to music, about its power, its purpose, its nature? Our capacity for creative acts, any of those things surrounding around our topic of playing with the arts?
Mm-hmm. You know, the Greeks thought that human beings were bodies and souls. And so they had education for the body and they had education for the soul. The education for the body was gymnastics. And that included a lot of things. Including, I was told just recently, included cooking. But it's all about the body, though. So gymnastics was the body. But what did they do for the soul? They taught music. Music was the education for the soul. Isn't that interesting?
Mm-hmm.
And Plato, in a couple of places, in the Republic and in the Symposium both, mentions how important it is to teach good music to children before they're reasonable, before they come to the age of reason. when they're very young, and teach them beautiful music, because it makes them early on attach their hearts to harmony, to the beauty of harmony, consonants. And that means that when they get to be older, he said, they would love beauty and harmony in other things even than music, certainly in music, but also in painting or in architecture or whatever. And as they got older and they were reasoning about it, they would be able to think metaphorically about harmony. That is, they would start seeing the benefits of, say, a harmonious business deal where one person gives seven things, the other person gives one thing, and the exchange is fair. Everyone thinks it's a fair trade. Or the harmony of harmony is this idea that disparate things, different things, can fit together in a kind of complementary fashion. You see, that's what harmony is. If you have two pitches of the same frequency, it's not considered harmony. It's only when you have pitches that are in ratio with one another that you get harmony, and your ear finds that appealing. So it has to do with ratio, and this is why music is one of the seven liberal arts. We teach music not just to listen to music. We teach music to be able to appreciate and understand the harmony of ratios. So Plato said, if you teach them harmony early on and their hearts are attached to it, then when they get older, they love harmony in a business deal or harmony in, say, marriage. Or eventually, they love harmony in the notion of justice. He thinks that if you love harmony as a young person, you'll love justice as an adult, because justice is a kind of harmony. When a man does something worth praising, the city ought to give him a medal or give him a parade or something. There's a kind of harmonious relationship between what he does and how the city responds. And the same thing on the negative side. If he breaks laws, then the city ought to punish him appropriately. But the punishment needs to fit the crime, you see. And all of those things are kinds of harmony. If you give somebody the death penalty for jaywalking, it's not harmonious. Right. It's not just.
Not in a ratio with it.
That's right. And so if you give, and if, on the reverse, if you have no penalties for murder, oh, murder, what the heck, you know, it doesn't make any difference, everything's fine, you have a dysfunctional society. And the result is it comes from a lack of ratio, a lack of proper harmony. So I just love the idea that music early on actually leads to justice later. That was Plato's idea. Yeah. I think as Christians, we bring a lot more to it than that. We recognize the revelation of the Word of God and what Jesus has done for us to make us right with God. Yeah. But the principle is still sort of there, that He Himself embodies the perfect harmony of God and man, and the relationship in the Trinity between the unity of the Trinity and the diversity of the Trinity is a kind of harmony. So at the very source of the Creator's person is a kind of harmony that then he creates in the world, and we can discover by way of our appreciation of the beautiful.
Wow. That's
so
profound.
Studying music is a very valuable thing to do.
Yeah. It reminds, in a way you could say that, based on what you were saying, that by listening to harmony or listening to things that are harmonious, it tunes my ear for the harmonious, but it also is in a way a preparation for me to accept by faith the truth of the Trinity. I have Muslims, one of the biggest things that stand in the way of seeing how Christianity can be true, and in a way we can't really see how it can be true, God reveals it to us, but is this idea that they don't see how the Trinity is not polytheism. And how can three things actually be one? And so I wonder how much this training in harmony could help aid in the jump that it requires in faith. Maybe I'm stretching too far. I probably am. I don't know.
Not at all. Not at all. I think you're really onto something there. And a friend of mine, Jeremy Begbie, has written a book about that idea, that theology actually could be better understood through music. Yeah, it's an interesting concept.
Yeah.
He talks about how the notes of a chord actually can be heard as a chord and as simultaneously as individual notes, and neither of them eclipses the other.
Wow.
So there you have it. Three notes, or however many there are in your chord, four, five sometimes, but three notes, more than two anyway, that are in harmony with one another, make up a single chord. If you take away any of those three original pitches, you don't have two-thirds of a chord. You just have two pitches that mean something else. But if you have all three together, they are one chord.
Wow. Wow, we could probably talk about this for the rest of our lives.
It's fascinating.
Yes. Wow. Well, I know our time is running out, and I want to respect your time for sure. Is there any last comments, maybe a resource that you would recommend for someone to take the step and actually take action on what we've done today for themselves?
Oh, sure. Good idea. Several people have written books that walk you through pieces of music, sort of like we did with Bernstein here. If you're really interested in hearing about the elements of music, we talked about melody, for example. We talked about harmony, how harmony changed under various melodies. We talked about rhythms. We talked a little bit about the form of these movements, where one piece was pitted against the other, or how two parts are explained the whole. Various things like that, the elements of music. I like to say that there are six of them. There's melody, harmony, rhythm, form, texture, and timbre. We could talk about those in a future time if you like. But those six, anyway, are talked about extensively in a book by the composer Aaron Copland called What to Listen For in Music. And it's a very good book for the layman and gives you a kind of introduction to those elements. And then when you listen for those elements, you begin to unlock the secrets of music.
Ooh,
that's a good book to have.
That sounds lovely. I actually already have it. The first time I heard you talk,
hey.
I got it right away.
Very good. Very good.
So
has it helped you? Does it make sense?
So far, I've only gotten into the introduction, so I'm walking slowly. I've put more classical music on my playlist and have that playing throughout the day. It's just, so that's something, a change that we've made in our home since then, which is fun. I wanted to give you an opportunity, if you wanted to, before we leave, to say anything about your gap year program.
Very good. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we run a thing called the Center for Western Studies, and part of that program is a gap year program for young people who want to take a year off between high school and college. To study two things with us. We have seven faculty members who are presently or formerly college professors in their fields that teach two things. These two things are a Christian view of the world and the history of Western ideas through the humanities, through the arts mainly. So we read in Homer at the beginning and we work our way through to the 20th century. We study along the way painting and architecture and music, like I did today with you, and also a little bit of philosophy, all in hopes that we'll get a hold of the significant ideas that Western civilization has put forth over the years. And then we do a bit of critiquing of Western civilization, too, because obviously Western civilization and Christianity are not the same thing, but there's been a tremendous influence of Christianity on the West, and that's worth sort of discussing and mulling over. So we hope that when students come to study with us for a year, they'll get a lot more out of their college years when they finally go the next year or whenever they go. Because they can learn from people who are not believers. They can be comfortable learning from people who are not Christians without having to embrace their presuppositions and not have their spiritual legs knocked out from under them, as so many who go off to college do these days.
Wow.
So we take them overseas. We rent an apartment in Paris, and we rent an apartment in London, and we take them over there to see the Louvre Museum and the Orangery and the Musée du Moyen Âge, the Middle Ages Museum, and the British Museum, and the National Gallery and the Westminster Abbey, take them to Chartres Cathedral in France, so that they get a sense of some of the artwork and some of the ideas that we have talked about throughout the year. So it's a great year, and we'd love to talk to anybody that would be interested in doing it. It's a tutorial program, so we keep the numbers very small, and we have one-on-one time with college professors and then discussion and lecture time like you would in a college classroom, in hopes that they'll be able to get a lot more out of their 4 years in college.
Wow, that sounds amazing. I'm signing my kids up. One question about GAP, do you know, and maybe this is something that we can, maybe I'll write about for the viewers, do you know how it affects, like if somebody wants to play sports in college and that sort of thing, do you know answers to those kind of questions?
I guess I don't know anything about sports in college, but I know about scholarships and all. We encourage seniors in high school to go on and apply to colleges that they want to apply to, and line up their scholarships and their arrangements and so on, and then ask for a year's deferral. And every college we've ever had has said, fine, that's no problem. They'll hold the scholarship for a year, and the student gets a chance to do this. In fact, a lot of people at Princeton now do this. In fact, Princeton has an office that sort of is a clearinghouse for gap year programs, and many of their freshmen, they suggest go and do a gap year before they come to Princeton. They hold their spot. And then send them off. And they do lots of things, not like necessarily our program, you know, but our program is actually going to be one of the ones listed in their list as of next year. We're hoping that that'll be the case.
Wow, that's exciting.
We're hoping that that'll be the way it works there. But a lot of people are beginning, this side of the ocean, are beginning to see the value of a gap year.
Yeah.
The Brits do it all the time, but the Americans are just now getting kind of a vision for it.
Right. Yeah, I read an article on the Harvard website, and they suggest actually a 1 to 2 year gap year. That would be their preference.
There you go. Harvard's doing it too then. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for all your time. Is it, unless you have anything else that you want to share with our viewers, then I think we can call our interview complete.
Okay. I think you'll put our website and information about our program right on your
absolutely.
Website. But if you look up centerws.com, you'll find our website, and it has all of our information about our gap year program and about our upcoming, we have an adult readers seminar that we do also online. We're starting in January. Yeah. So every other Tuesday night, we're going to have reading assignments for everybody to read, and then we'll get online like you and I are doing right now and talk about the books that are being discussed. So if there are adults out there that would like to get in on this kind of conversation about music and about books in particular, they can check that out on our website as well.
Oh, that sounds wonderful. I know the educators that read Expanding Wisdom are always looking for opportunities to start entering into the tradition, and they so that's great to know. Thank you for sharing that, and I'll include links to all of these things on our page, so no worries about that. And thank you so much for being here with us, for talking with us, for leading us through music and setting a vision for us of what listening to music can be. I really appreciate it.
Many thanks, Jennifer. I enjoyed it greatly, and I'll look forward to seeing you again.
Sounds great. Thank you. Same here.
Bye-bye.
Bye.